Hey guys, in this video, you're going to learn about AWS Auto Scaling. So Auto Scaling is actually a family of different options for how we can automatically scale our resources on AWS. So Auto Scaling automatically scales services, including EC2. So this is the most common one that we're going to use quite a lot in the course. With Amazon EC2 auto scaling, we can launch or terminate EC2 instances automatically. So the auto scaling service will do that for us. Then we've got EC2 spot fleets. So when you're using the spot pricing model, Amazon Elastic Container Service. Here it's adjusting the service desired count up and down. So the way that we define how many containers we want to run in ECS is by creating a service, and it then modifies the number of containers that we want to have running automatically for us. Then we've got DynamoDB, where we use read capacity units and write capacity units, and it will automatically modify those to change the amount of resources that are assigned to DynamoDB. We've also got Aurora, where it will adjust the number of read replicas. So read replicas are for serving read requests, and we can have them automatically scale, so it will launch or terminate new read replicas. Now, EC2 auto scaling is the one we'll concentrate on the most. So with EC2 auto scaling, we have instances running, we've created an auto scaling group here, and we define a desired count for how many instances we actually want to run in that auto scaling group. Now, it works with CloudWatch, the performance monitoring service, to validate what the resource utilization is. So these instances are constantly sending metrics to CloudWatch saying how much resource is being utilized. And if they become overutilized, or if an instance fails, that gets reported to CloudWatch. So in this example here, an EC2 instance has failed, so the status checks have failed. And that means that information gets reported to CloudWatch, and CloudWatch then talks to Auto Scaling, which launches a new EC2 instance to replace the one that failed. So that's replacing a failed instance. Now, in another example, let's say that a metric is being reported that says that the aggregate CPU across the instances is greater than 80%. And we might have configured an alarm via auto scaling that says that once the utilization exceeds 80%, we want more instances to be launched. So CloudWatch will notify auto scaling to scale, and it will then launch an instance. So now it's adding instances because we need more capacity for our application. Auto scaling launches or terminates instances for us dynamically. Scaling in this case is horizontal, we're scaling out. It provides elasticity and scalability. So obviously it scales seamlessly or elastically. And elastically really means that it has the ability to expand outwards and then back in again. So when our resources then become less utilized, then of course instances can be terminated so we can be more cost effective. It also responds to EC2 status checks and CloudWatch metrics. It can scale based on demand, so performance, or on a schedule. So it's not just about performance metrics. You could define a specific time when you know that you're going to need more capacity. Scaling policies define how to respond to changes in demand, and we can configure those in auto scaling. Auto scaling groups are what we create to define collections of instances that get scaled and managed together. And that's where we then define the policies for how that scaling actually happens. So how do we configure an auto scaling group? Well, one way is we can use something called a launch template. This specifies the configuration of the EC2 instances that we're going to launch, like which AMI are we going to use, what's the network configuration, and so on. So lots of different things you can configure here. The AMI and instance type, the EBS volumes, the security groups, the key pairs, and so on and so on. Now, we can also use something called a launch config. It's an older construct. We tend to use launch templates more because, as you can see, there are fewer options with a launch config. You could say that launch configs have been replaced by launch templates, though both are still available. You then get to configure the purchase options, whether it's on-demand instances or spot. You can configure the VPCs and subnets your auto scaling group will launch instances into, and you can optionally attach a load balancer. You can also configure the health checks for EC2 as well as elastic load balancing. And define, of course, your group size and the scaling policies you want to use. So with auto scaling, we have health checks. Now, there's a couple of different types. We've got EC2. These are the EC2 status checks. So as per the visual example I showed you before, if the status checks fail, then it means that there's a problem with the instance, and so auto scaling will replace that instance. The other is ELB, so elastic load balancing. That means that it will also use the ELB health check. So the key here is that it's in addition to the EC2 status checks. So that means that it's also going to utilize the information that's coming from elastic load balancing service. If an ELB finds that a target in a target group is unhealthy, it will report that also to auto scaling. So auto scaling knows to take it out of action, terminate the instance, as well as elastic load balancing, which is going to remove it from service as well. We then have the health check grace period. This is how long to wait before checking the health status of the instance after it is launched. And this is defined based on how long we think it's going to be before the application is ready. Auto scaling doesn't act on health checks until the grace period expires. So that means it's not going to, for example, terminate an instance because the application port's not available and we know that it's just not ready yet. Maybe it just takes another couple of minutes. So we want to give more of a health check grace period to prevent that from happening. Now, there are different types of auto scaling. We've got dynamic. This means auto scaling automatically scales based on demand. Predictive uses machine learning to predict what's likely to happen in the future. And scheduled will scale based on a schedule that you can define. Now let's have a look at different types of policy we have. So the first one here is called target tracking. This will increase and decrease the capacity of your auto scaling group based on a CloudWatch metric and a target value. Now, for example here, you might want to keep your aggregate CPU usage at around 70%. So what this will mean is that if your average CPU utilization goes above 70%, then the auto scaling group will launch instances. And if it drops down below 70%, then it will terminate instances to try and get that percentage of utilization about 70%. We then have step scaling. Here it will increase and decrease the capacity of the group based on a set of scaling adjustments. These are known as step adjustments, and they can be different based on the size of the alarm breach. So if you have a much bigger breach, so for example, the utilization jumps up by a large amount, then you can have a certain number of instances launch. And if it jumps up by a small amount, then you can have fewer instances launched. And then we have simple scaling. Here you're increasing and decreasing the capacity of the group based on a single scaling adjustment. So it's a bit more simple than step scaling or target tracking. Now we've also got monitoring with auto scaling. We have group metrics. These are data points about the auto scaling group. They have 1 minute granularity and there's no charge. They also must be enabled manually. Basic monitoring is for instances. This is 5 minute granularity and there's no charge. We also have detailed monitoring for instances. That's 1 minute granularity and charges do apply. Let's have a look at some additional scaling settings that are important to understand for the exam. There's something called a cooldown. This is used with a simple scaling policy to prevent auto scaling from launching or terminating before the effects of previous activities are visible. And the default value is 5 minutes. So this is trying to prevent some erratic behavior with launching and terminating instances. It's given a bit of a time for things to cool down so that it knows what's going on before making any more changes to the auto scaling group. There's also a termination policy. This controls which instances to terminate first when a scale in event occurs. And it's worth looking this one up and understanding the different termination policies. There's also termination protection. This prevents auto scaling from terminating protected instances. So we can define an instance as being protected and then it cannot be terminated by the ASG. Now a standby state is used to put an instance that's in the in-service state, that just means simply that it's in operation, into a standby state. And you can do that so that you can troubleshoot any issues with that instance without actually taking it out of action. And while you do so, it's not going to trigger any actions by the auto scaling group. We also have lifecycle hooks. These are used to perform custom actions by pausing instances as the ASG launches or terminates them. Use cases are doing things like running a script to install software or pausing an instance to process some data before a scale-in event happens, a termination. And it looks kind of like this. So we have our scale out happening, the instance goes into pending, and then we can put it into a pending wait while we run a lifecycle hook. And at this point, we could actually run some code of our choice. And then finally, when an instance terminates, you can do the same thing. You could get it to pause while you actually run whatever code you need to run.